TipTut.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to TipTut, and welcome back to the finale of intro to Adobe Animate. Wow, what a journey we have been on today. Today, we're just going to tidy up this animation, add a few glowy effects and things like that, and then we're going to call it a day. So as you can see at the moment, we've got our jump, he kicks the ball in the air, and we've got some powerful magic-y stuff that comes out of his feet when he jumps and when he kicks. So we're just going to add another layer to this to make, to basically illustrate the point that A, you don't have to do everything at once. You can come back and do things on top. And in fact, it is encouraged to do so, because it allows you to get a greater level of detail. And B, so that we can add some cool glowing effects using specifically motion clips as opposed to graphics. And you'll see what that means in a minute when we get to that. So first of all, I'm just going to find the frame where our first bit of magic starts, which is here. And I've selected just a slightly lighter blue. To show that this is in the way the sort of fire works, you know, the whiter the fire is, the hotter it is. I'm going to do that sort of similar effect here, but with this power that's coming out of his feet. So I'm just finding the right brush thickness here. That'll probably do one down from there. That's nice. And I'm just going to do some really small and really intricate details on this, just so that there's a bit more variation to his sort of power blast, if that makes sense. Now, this doesn't need to be too accurate because it's quite small. So there's a thing where you can kind of just go a bit freehand with this, making sure, of course, that you're doing all the lines in the right directions. Zoom out a bit there so we can see a bit easier. Here, for example, you can tell where the power is sort of shooting out and where it's emanating from. And we're literally just adding in a few extra lines as sort of ripples, if that makes sense. Offshoots of this power where it's burning up in the air. Now again, this is all up to open to interpretation. If you don't like this, then do it, you know, simple. I happen to think it adds a bit of intricacy to the animation. Then again, I am just drawing a stick man jumping into the air. So you can kind of do what you want, really. The reason I'm doing a stick man is because I used to love watching these things when I was a kid on Newgrounds. And they're actually what got me into animation in the first place. So I figured, hey, why not teach you guys how to animate with the thing that got me into animating? Seemed to make sense. So apologies if it doesn't appeal to you, but these principles can be applied to anywhere, to any style of animation. Not necessarily this episode so much, because we're just talking about visuals here for this specific thing. But the previous episodes certainly can be applied to any kind of animation. Squash and stretch and working with frame by frame and motion tweening and things like that. That all applies to every style of animation you could possibly think of. So it's always good to know. That's my brother logging in now. He's playing a bit of City Skylines. Good for you, Dan. Keep it up. I'm working away on a Sunday and he's playing video games. Wish I could do that. So, just adding a few extra lines of power to these shapes. Now, the key thing when you're doing stuff like this is thinking where the force is emanating from. At this point, it's obviously from his foot, so all the lines are going to come in like a circle blowout around that. So it's just making sure that if I was to do a line of power like this, for example, it would be quite jarring. So it's just making sure that all of our lines are roughly following the same power emphasis point, the point of origin. Doesn't have to be too accurate, of course, but it's good if it is, because it just helps later down the line. There you go. So that seems okay. So let's just quickly hide those guides, because we don't actually need them anymore. In fact, we might as well delete them, because we're not going to do any more animation with the man's body. So we might as well just delete the guides layer for now. Fill the screen. Give us a bit more breathing room and see what that looks like. Bam. There you go. So that just adds like another level of detail. It makes it feel a bit less cartoony. You see the difference between the big blob of the ball and the quite intricate detailing on the magic. Just emphasizes it a lot more. Okay, so now then what we're going to do is I'm going to show you how to nest already drawn animation into a graphic, specifically into a motion clip, as they're called. So what I'm going to do is grab all of the frames that I've just drawn, possibly also the frames of the previous effects as well, do you think? Is that a good idea? Let's just find out what layer they're on. And the layer below. And on this layer as well, I believe. Yes. Okay. Right then. Let's do that then. So I'm going to grab the frames from all of these layers here, making sure that there is something on the first frame. Okay. Whether they can be as small as you like, it doesn't matter. Just making sure there is something on the first frame. So grab all of these frames here, and I'm going to right click and choose copy frames. Okay. Then zooming out again, so I've got a bit of breathing room. I'm just going to go up to insert and choose new symbol. And we're going to choose movie clip. I keep saying motion clip. I'm sorry about that. If I've ever said motion clip, I mean movie clip. It's just I taught myself ages ago that it was the wrong word and I keep doing it. So we're going to make a movie clip. And this is a movie clip as opposed to a graphic. Now, the eyes were a graphic that we made before so that we can see them blinking within the timeline. However, that does limit the amount of effects that you can apply to it. So if you wanted to work using a graphic so you could see the animation as it takes place within the timeline, that's fine. But then if you wanted to apply extra effects to it, you'd have to change it to a movie clip, which would only then run its internal timeline when you test the movie with control enter or, you know, file test, anything like that. Otherwise, you won't see the animation. So what we'll do is we'll make this as a graphic to start off with, and we'll just call it magic. Okay, and we'll hit OK. And that gives us a little nested timeline where we're going to paste these frames. Okay, and now you can see why it was important we had something on the first frame. Because if we drop back into our first scene, like so, into our timeline here, scene 5 for me, because I've got all the other tutorial assets in here as well. But for you, you'll probably only have one scene. If you drop back into your scene, you just need to add a new layer now, preferably underneath the rest of your effects layers, with a keyframe on the first place where your effect actually comes into existence, okay? Then if you go down to your library, which if you don't have, you can just go to Window and then Library, or Control L as the shortcut to bring it up, and find the symbol that we just made, okay? And then just drag that out onto the timeline, okay? Now, as you can see, when we click this, the center is way, way off, because when we create a new graphic or symbol from the stage, it creates it the size of the stage. So if we were to position this correctly, that would be sort of offset. It doesn't matter, doesn't do anything. It would only affect it if you were to rotate, but even then it only affects the rotation of that frame. So it doesn't really matter. It's just a little quirky thing that Flash does. Now we want, if we played this, for example, you can see now we have a duplicate of our magic effect, but it's nested within its own timeline. So we can squash and stretch and alpha fade and things like that on this. Now, to get this lined up, we want to keep it as a graphic for now. So let's just zoom right in. Okay. And we'll line up this first frame with the one that's already on. Now, it should just snap if you've got those sort of settings applied. But if it doesn't, don't worry too much. You can just do it sort of, you can eyeball it sort of pixel by pixel. Okay. Now, if you wanted to be extra careful about it, you could then go through and delete these three layers. I'm going to leave them in just to see what it looks like. And the way to test it is to just then play that, hence why we're leaving it as a graphic for now. Okay, so now we can see that it looks the same because it's directly underneath it. Now it is going to loop because the graphic timeline will loop continuously unless you close it off. So you want to find your last frame where there's no more magic and then just hit F7 to do a blank keyframe. That closes it off and that stops it from looping. Okay, so now we've got the internal timeline of this segment here. If I were to open it up, but I'll probably zoom in because I can't quite click it. Like so, if I were to open this up, you'll see that these frames, the amount of frames, which is 28, matches up perfectly with the 28 frames that we have here and animates perfectly along it. Okay, so now we know that it's matched up and it's in the right place. We can re-visible those other layers. And we can change this instance of that graphic away from being a graphic and turning it into a movie clip. Okay, so with that little graphic selected, you can just go up to the properties of it. Now, you do have to have the graphic selected and not the layer. That's very important. Otherwise, you get a different set of properties. So, for example, you might have to hide your layers above if you've kept them. and then click your graphics. You can see here I've got one set of properties. If I then went to revisible those layers up there, it turns back to the layer properties. So that's, if you're not seeing the right thing, that's probably what you've done. So select your graphic and then simply change it to a movie clip. And what this does is this gives you a lot more control over different filters that you can apply. For example, I can now apply a filter, which is a blur filter, maybe 2 pixels. I can apply a second filter, which is a glow, which I'm going to make a really fluorescent blue. And I'm going to make this glow quite big, maybe 10 pixels with a high quality. You can do a knockout, which basically removes everything apart from the glow. And you can do an inner glow, which appears inside of whatever it is that you've drawn. Could be useful, not in this circumstance, however. And then I'm probably going to add one more thing. Maybe we add a little adjust color and then just bring that brightness up a bit, like so. Maybe 40. That seems about right. Okay. 40. Yeah, that's good. So now we have 3 effects here that we couldn't have applied if our movie clip was a graphic rather than a movie clip. Okay. So next then, all we want to do is just apply or revisible those layers on top. And you can see now that we have a nice glowing effect underneath. Let's drop out of that so we can see that glow. And some hard ones on top. Now this does get unfortunately a bit lost because now that it's a movie clip, you can't see it to test, okay? So the only way to see it, test this, is to play or test the movie. So I'm just gonna line up, remove some of these excess frames so that we know that we don't have to watch too much dead air when we're looping. And we're just gonna test the film. Bam. That's our test one that I did before. And here's the one we made now. There you go, nice cool glowing effect. There's the test one we did before. And there's a nice glowing effect, etc. So that basically closes off the intro to Adobe Animate series. We've gone through frame by frame animation. We've gone through motion tweening. We've gone through nesting timelines in graphics. We've gone through movie clips. we've gone through applying filters. We've gone through combination of frame by frame and motion tweening. That should be enough to get you started with Animate CC. I'm planning to do a sort of intermediate series on this software where we take a look at cameras, we take a look at motion paths and things like that, and creating a bit more of a complicated animation, maybe lifting something from one of my previous channel update videos which I've made in Flash, possibly, who knows. But let me know if that's something you've been interested in. Let me know if you've enjoyed this series, if there's anything you want me to change or do better next time, anything like that. And hopefully I'll see you then for intermediate Adobe Animate, who knows. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you all next time.
Remember to subscribe for more tips, tricks, and tutorials. Thanks for watching.